Hi everybody, Alaina from PC World here. I am here today to show you Intel's latest NUC, which is their mini PC line. This is the Hades Canyon NUC. Well, used to be called that. That was the code name. Now it has one of those kind of insanely long names that Intel likes to give its mini PCs. I think it's something like the NUC 8 i7 HVK. It's a little bit of a mouthful. 2 years ago, I actually got to review its predecessor, which is this fella here. This one was codenamed Skull Canyon. As you can see, there's a nice little skull here on the top. This one was really awesome. I actually ended up giving it a 5 out of 5 at the time. I also really like this particular NUC, which is codenamed Hades Canyon. And sometimes I wonder if it's codenamed that because, you know, Hades, God of Hell, Intel partnering with AMD, hell freezing over. I don't know if that's kind of a reference to that. I think it's kind of funny if it is. But this one is a lot more powerful. It has a discrete GPU, which the Skull Canyon NUC did not have. This one had integrated graphics, although the best at the time. And as a result, this is actually a lot more expensive too. So there's two models this time around. This one we have is $1,000 for the bare bones system. So that means it doesn't come with any storage or RAM or even the OS. You have to provide all of that on your own, or you have to find a reseller who's actually selling it as a complete system. This is the model we have, the $1,000 model. There's also another model, which is a step down, that's $800 as a bare bones system. Again, no storage, no RAM, no OS. And that one is, like I said, $800. It's a little bit slower. This one, on the CPU side of things, it has a processor that runs at 3.1 gigahertz base, goes up to 4.2 gigahertz as turbo. The lower model is similar. It's 3.1 base and 4.1 for turbo. On the graphic side of things, so like I said earlier, this has a discrete GPU. It's a, what was the name? It's a long string of words here. It's a Radeon RX Vega M graphics, and this one is the Vega MGH version. That one is, I believe, about, was it 1063 megahertz, so 1063 megahertz for base clock, and then I think it's like 1190 megahertz for the turbo or the boost clock. If you go a step down to the $800 model, I think everything's about 100 megahertz slower. So there is a small performance difference. And it's really, I mean, we didn't get to test that model, but honestly, I would, if I was going to choose, I would just go with this $1,000 model, because if you're going to put that much into a small bare bones system, you may as well just go for the top end. This is actually a little, again, different from Skull Canyon in that this was not overclockable. This actually is. Unfortunately, I didn't have enough time before the embargo lifted for our review to do that. I actually still plan to, so stay tuned and check out the written review to see updates for that. Intel told us that they were able to get as high as, I think, 4.7 gigahertz for their overclock. Again, that's all based on, you know, if you win the Silicon Lottery or not. So we'll see what we got in this particular fella. In general, it runs really cool. And I feel like that's kind of a question a lot of people who, you know, use mini PCs or into mini PCs want to know. And by cool, what I mean is that the fans don't really get that loud. When I had a full CPU utilization, didn't really hear the fans. The only time I heard the fan was when I was running games. And even then, it was still a fairly quiet fan hum. It's not shrill. It's not, you know, unbearable. I have a couple other mini PCs here, like, so this Gigabyte Bricks, which I reviewed a long, long time ago, has a very loud, very shrill fan that just kind of runs whenever there's a, you know, heavy load, whatever, you know, task you're throwing at it. That is not the case here. This is definitely far higher end, far more premier level of a mini PC. As I mentioned earlier, or if I didn't, there is this LED you get on the front with this one, and it's configurable. So I don't know if you can see here on the screen that you can actually change the colors. And as we all know, RGB makes everything go faster. That's, spoiler, that's actually not true, but If you want to play around with it, you can. So you can change the outline of the skull, you can change the color of the eyes. This actually defaults to, I think, a red and blue scheme. I chose purple and yellow for funsies, but you can, you know, go ahead and play with that. There's different patterns, so there's the breathing, the strobing, and the pulsing options that you can choose from. And you can even customize the colors on the front for the three LEDs right here. So that's the customization. I think everyone probably wants to know, as I did, how it performs when you play games on it. So I would say in general, the Vega MGH part that we have in here is kind of falls between GTX 1050 Ti and a GTX 1060 Max-Q that you'd find on laptops. I was getting, for current games, I should preface this. So current games, I played PUBG, but I'm not really a much of a PUBG player. So I spent most of my time on the fringe of the map, trying one, not to get killed, and two, just to figure out where I was supposed to go, because as I'm revealing here, I really don't play PUBG. So with that in mind, I was getting about mid-50s for average frame rate on high, and it felt pretty smooth. But again, because I was in the thick of things and I wasn't, you know, running around with other people shooting at me, I don't know how much of a frame drop you would see and how that would affect the average frame rate. For games that aren't quite so variable, I played, I brought up Shadow of War, so Middle Earth Shadow of War, which was released last October, so it's a fairly new game. If you put that game on Ultra, then you're gonna get about mid-30s for frame rate. So not that great. So if you step it down to high, it jumps up to about mid-40s. And then if you finally step it down to, what is it, medium or normal, whatever they call the next step down, then you finally hit that golden, you know, over 60 rate. So I think it's like low 60s at that point. Starting to step back further, you know, in time, Rise of the Tomb Raider, got about 51 frames per second in, very high. And DX11, and then Shadow of Mordor, so the older Middle Earth Shadow series game, that one was about low 50s, I believe, for Ultra, so with 4K texture pack on. And then just rounding out our benchmarks, Tomb Raider. Interesting how it didn't quite scale very well, but Tomb Raider, which is like, what, 5 years old now, if you put on Ultimate, I got just over 60 frames per second, which was a little strange, but it scales with what I got on the Skull Canyon NUC, which was, gosh, I think that one's like barely like mid-20s for that particular set of settings. So all in all, it's a really good little PC. I mean, if you have the money to spare, if you need something that's really compact, it's gonna be really hard to beat this. I know that other vendors like, you know, Gigabyte and Zotac have their own systems with discrete graphics, you know, like NVIDIA discrete graphics. And they'll probably outperform this by a good margin, but they're gonna be bigger. So if you fall in that camp of people that don't need that extra screen and just really want to not have to worry about the constraints of, you know, laptop plumbing, basically, you know, with all, where everything goes, with the heat sinks and everything, which can affect performance, then this really is going to be a great choice for you. I am really looking forward to seeing what else I can get out of it. If you'd like to see the full rundown of what I find out, you can check out our written review on PCWorld.com. And that's it for now. Thanks for tuning in.